Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. In our last segment, we introduced the topic of equity. We started talking about why it's important and what it is, how it's different than debt financing, and then we talked about the differences between the different forms of equity. And we ended by saying that we were going to continue our discussion focusing on corporations. With that in mind, let's take a little bit of time now to talk about how we record the issuance of stock to our stockholders. In other words, how we track their investments into our business. Now, how we record the issuance of our stock depends on whether we have a par value or not. Now, a par value is actually an old idea. It's not as useful now as it used to be. The original idea was that when you registered with a state to become incorporated, they would insist that you provide a guess at what you think your stock was going to be worth as your company started. It was a way to signal to potential investors, we think we're going to be worth $10 a share, or $2 a share, or $5 a share, or $25 a share, or whatever you picked. And that was the one signal that investors would get. The company thinks they're worth this much, and here's some old financial data and whatever to make your decision on. Nowadays, there's a lot of indications on what a company should sell for, the best coming from analysts and investment banks who spend a lot of time analyzing the company and guessing at what it's really worth at the moment. So because of that, we don't really need a par value anymore because we get the information somewhere else. Unfortunately, the basis of par value is in the legal documents required for incorporating a company. So unless the state where you are incorporating has changed the law or never did have a par value requirement in the law, we still have to declare a par value. So what most companies have done now is they've chosen a very small par value, $1.50, some very minimal amount. Why? Because of the way we do the accounting. You see, from an accounting perspective, we put the par value into the common stock account. If people pay more than that to get these first shares, then we put the extra into what we call additional paid in capital. So essentially capital paid or invested in the company beyond what we thought they should have to. That's what this account is for. So it used to be that this was a great signal. You could show people, this is what we thought the company was worth, and here's the money that people gave us because they really thought we were worth that much, and then here's a little extra that company gave, that investors gave to us too. Now, because we choose such nominal values, and there's really no value in the par, we really would like to have all of that information together. So the best way to do that, given the legal requirements, is to make par value as small as possible. So you're just shaving off a dollar or so of the real value into par, and the rest of it goes into additional paid in capital. So that additional paid in capital account really becomes the better measure of what investors have really put into the company. Of course, there are states out there that don't have the par value requirement. When there's no par value, we don't have a common stock and additional paid in capital accounts. We just put everything into common stock and that's it. We just don't have to worry about having the two accounts. Now, IFRS has the same exact process, but they call everything a different name. So let's take just a second and run through the names of these accounts under IFRS. We call it common stock, they call it share capital. Under US GAAP, we call it paid in capital in excess of par or additional paid in capital, they call it share premium, which goes back to the idea we used with bonds, that if you pay extra for something, we call it a premium. We call it retained earnings. They give companies options. You can call it retained earnings, you can call it retained profits, or you can call it accumulated profit or loss. The last account that ends up in our equity section of the balance sheet on a regular basis is accumulated other comprehensive income. And again, this is all that stuff that's changed assets that we had no control over. So changes in currency translations, changes in the current value of our available for sale securities that we aren't trading, etc. And because we don't really control it, we don't put it in the income statement. We just kind of lump it all together in this one account called additional comprehensive income and stick it below retained earnings on our balance sheet. Under IFRS, they don't call it accumulated other comprehensive income. They call it the general reserve and other reserve accounts. So not a difference in how we do things, just a difference in what we call things under IFRS. Enough concepts. On to the journal entries. I'm excited. It's time to get started here. Here's our example company, MSR Incorporated, and they've decided to issue 100,000 shares of stock. Currently, the market price is $54 per share, and we want to make the journal entry if they've got a $5 par value. Now, we don't spend a lot of time on finance terms in this class because we're focused on the accounting, but there are two important finance terms that you should be familiar with from an accounting perspective, and that is an IPO and an SEO. An IPO is the initial public offering. It's the first time a company sells stock on the open market. It's governed by the SEC. It's heavily regulated. There's a lot going on with an IPO. An SEO is a seasoned equity offering. It's when we go back to the market and sell more stock. And again, we have to get permission from the SEC to do it. We have to file a bunch of forms. We have to give plenty of notice. And then we can issue this stock. It's kind of a pain in the neck, but it's the only way a corporation can raise capital is with either an IPO or an SEO. So just so you're aware, those are two important terms that you really should be comfortable with. So in this case, since they're issuing additional shares, it's an SEO. And we need to start this process by figuring out how much cash we're going to get. That's going to be the number of shares we're selling times the current market value. So this company, MSR, is going to actually get $5.4 million from this equity offering. So not bad. And now that I know the cash, I can put that into a journal entry. We'll debit cash. Next, we're going to credit the common stock account. We're showing this money going into equity because the equity holders are going to have claim on these resources as the business continues. So they have a par value in this case, and the rule is into the common stock account, we put only the par value. So of the 5.4 million, only 500,000 is going to go into common stock, and the rest is going to go into additional paid in capital common stock. And I apologize if you don't like the abbreviations, but C stock is a pretty common abbreviation, not only in accounting, but throughout the financial industry. So let's see, to make this balance, 4.9 million needs to go into additional paid in capital common stock. Issued 100,000 shares of common stock. Now, you'll notice I call this additional paid in capital common stock, not just additional paid in capital. That actually is really important because we have a number of additional paid in capital accounts. We have one for common stock, one for preferred stock, one for treasury stock. There's others when we start issuing stock options, etc. So you do need to differentiate. This is the additional paid in capital common stock. Make sure you don't forget the label. Let's do it now. What if MSR had no par value? Well, then the journal entry is even easier. So I'm still getting the same amount of cash because it's still 100,000 shares at 54 bucks a share. So 5.4 million. And since I have no par value, it all goes into the common stock account. I didn't put no par value in this description. I didn't put the $5 par value in the other description because that's just common knowledge for our business. The par value appears in our literature. It appears in our balance sheet. I don't have to put it in the description for our journal entry. These are great, aren't they? They're just basic journal entries, keeping track of the money coming in from our investors. Nice to have some simple ones after all the fun we've been dealing with long-term debt and current liabilities. Before we transition off this slide, though, this non-par value provides us with a perfect opportunity to show you what this investment would look like if it wasn't a corporation. So what if instead of going to the public market and having common stock and selling all these shares, what if instead we just had a normal owner and it was a sole proprietorship or a partnership and we went to one of our owners or our one owner and said, we need $5 million, make an investment so we can grow? Well, if it was a sole proprietorship or partnership, then this entry would still have a debit to cash, but now we'd put it in the owner's named account, so Jason's equity. Now, with a sole proprietorship, it doesn't matter that we name it because there's just one owner. He or she gets everything. But in a partnership, it really matters whose account this goes into, because not only is it going to change what assets that individual can claim, it's also going to change what portion they own and therefore what portion of our profit they might get. And that depends on the partnership contract, etc. But often that partnership contract says the more you put in, the more the profit you get. And so we really want to make sure we keep track of whose profit that is. And this is an investment by owner. Pretty much the same, just a change in the account title. We've looked at what happens when they invest cash. What happens when they don't invest cash? What if they give us some other asset instead? So a non-cash transaction. And there's a general rule here, and the general rule is that in a non-cash transaction, you record the common stock at the value of the asset that you receive. So you don't go out and say, well, the market value is $100 per share. I give you 100 shares, so it's a $10,000 asset, and then I record my common stock as normal. No, instead you say, that asset's worth $9,000. I give you 100 shares. So instead of getting the $100 by selling the stock on the open market, I only got 90 bucks a share. So I'll put in $90 as my common stock value. That's what we mean with this. So here's MSR again. Now we've got an additional 10,000 shares being issued for a $500,000 plot of land. That's its market value. Stock is still selling at 54 bucks a share. We want to make the journal entry if they have that same $5 par value. Well, again, we record the value of this asset at its market value and let the common stock fall out at whatever it needs to be to make this balance. So let's see. I need to credit common stock. And because we have a par value, I'm only going to be able to put into that common stock account the 10,000 shares times the $5 par. So of the 500,000, only 50,000 will go into common stock. The rest goes into additional paid in capital common stock. And the company will just never get that extra $40,000 that they could have gotten if they'd sold the shares on the market and then gone and bought the land for the $500,000. Received land in exchange for 10,000 shares of common stock. Let's look at this one more time. What would this look like if there was no par value? We debit land for $500,000. We credit common stock for $500,000, and that's it. Received land in exchange for 10,000 shares of common stock. Now, what if it was a sole proprietorship? That's all there is to it. Recording the issuance of common stock is really that straightforward, that simple. Most of our transactions with owners are, because we've done all the hard work in recording our assets and liabilities and coming up with a profit and recording closing entries. So what we do with the owners themselves stays pretty straightforward. What we need to talk about next is what happens when we decide as a company to buy back some of those shares. It's called treasury stock, and we'll talk about it in our next segment. I'll see you then.